Soy loco por ti, América. Soy loco por ti de amores. Soy loco por ti, América. Loco por ti de amores. Soy loco por ti, América. Soy loco por ti de amores. Soy loco por ti, América. Loco por ti de amores.
Greetings, everyone, and thank you very much for participating in this seminar, Thinking About the World and Latin America in the Caribbean Post-COVID-19, called for by AICA, thinking about the scenarios we can have after we have overcome the health crisis. So we have to think about the policies that have to be implemented given these new realities to avoid greater risks on global food security. Today, we will be talking about innovation systems and value chains in the post-COVID-19 world. In the latest years, climate change has already brought great pressures to food production. The pandemic is only increasing this and is threatening to double the number of people that suffer from hunger today. Although food production has continued in most countries, and we have been able to keep contagion outside and continue producing, there is a risk to access to food. The new realities, in economic realities through quarantines and all the measures taken to avoid progression of the disease has led to many people losing their employment and not being able to access food. Given that situation, value chains in the agri-food sector start from the small producers. And small producers are the ones at greatest risk here. If they cannot sell their products because fairs and markets have closed, they don't have the logistics to access markets, they might even decide to stop producing. So today we have two distinguished guests to talk about how innovation can help value chains continue operating. We are joined by Dr. Elsa Murano, Director of the Borla Institute for International Agriculture, Professor and Emeritus Professor of Texas A&M University. Dr. Murano studied biological sciences, a Master of Science in Microbiology, and PhD in Technology and Food Technology from Virginia Tech. She started as an Assistant Professor in Microbiology in Iowa in 1990 and has led research for food safety and security and was named and was in charge of the program for radiation and food. She joined Texas A&M as an associate professor and led the Center for Food there. And she also was awarded with a professorship from the university. She has received external resources and funding for research, has published several articles and 7 chapters in books in the topic of food safety. In 2001, that then President George Bush named her Undersecretary for Agriculture for Food Safety, the highest position in that sense in the country. Then she went back to Texas A&M. And in 2008, she became the first woman and Hispanic president of Texas A&M University. Since June 2012, she has been a director of the Institute for International Agriculture, working on poverty matters and food safety. We are also joined by Juan Lucas Restrepo, Director General of the International Alliance for Biodiversity and the Center for International Agriculture Technologies. He is a civil engineer, Master of Sciences from Cornell University. In the past 25 years, he has worked in agriculture publicly and privately and has broad experience in food chains, markets, and leading agricultural innovation. He has had several positions in executive committees, representative of the Colombian government and the SIAD Directorate. He has been Minister of Rural Development in Colombia, also worked with associations of coffee growers, with AgroSavia, the largest agricultural research organization in Colombia, has also worked with innovation and knowledge. He's also led the World Forum for Agricultural Research in FAO, leading research and community innovations for agriculture workers. Publicly, he has worked as a member of the Colombian delegation for plant resources and in the innovation system for agriculture in the country to promote innovation for farmers, helping them improve their quality of life and to protect their natural capital. Welcome. Thank you very much. I did want to introduce you first. It's important for people to know who we are talking with. And now I invite you to give us a brief presentation each, and afterwards we can start our conversation. Just as a reminder, anyone who is not speaking, please mute your audios to ensure we don't have any noise in the background. Elsa, I invite you to now share your views and what you believe are the challenges. Thank you very much. First of all, it is a great pleasure for me to be here and discuss such an important topic in the midst of the crisis we are living through, something we had never foreseen. So to begin, I'd like to talk about the challenges we see now in the short term, the immediate challenges, the abrupt fall in demand for food, the restrictions on international trade, many countries closing their international trade, not importing or exporting anything, disruptions in productive systems because of quarantine measures, processing plants being closed, employees unable to work for several reasons, or to go to work. There's no availability of input, whether that's seeds, fertilizer, funding, again, non-existent, given the economic crisis we're also going through. Labor is also hard to find. And so these short-term challenges are greatly important. But even after we overcome the COVID-19 crisis, and when we start restructuring everything, we will find other challenges, the medium-term challenges, that we will also have to deal with. These challenges are related to new consumption patterns, new demand patterns in international markets, changes in consumer preferences towards foods that they might consider healthier or that are more sustainably produced, greater requirements in terms of food safety and quality of the food as well by different governments. So if we look at all these challenges, in the short term, we need rapid response, of course, digital tools to once again enable the commercial channels that will allow us to trade again as quickly as possible. Technology that can help us improve production efficiency of food, so we may take advantage of surplus or any way to change the chains we've had. For example, if we have some kind of a barrier, an obstacle at some point, that we can switch gears and find a way to bring food elsewhere. For example, food that was being sent or sold to restaurants, how to use it and send it through another chain. Technology that helps us ensure that the food is healthy, safe. Traceability that allows us to track and trace any problem so that we can understand where, for example, contamination happened, because food safety systems may have already fallen, so we need to once again enable them. So after this first part, and when we start looking at the recovery period, as I said, we need to restructure production, processing. Everything has to be adapted to the changes we will see in consumers. We need protocols that are more productive, that meet new standards, because the food quality and safety standards will become stricter and stricter. And also exploring possibilities how to more directly link producers to consumers so that we avoid so many steps in between. If there's any problem and something stops, we want to avoid the fact that everything else stops. We need to find a way for producers to be more directly related to consumers to avoid those types of issues. There are many technologies, many things related to the internet, of course, biotechnology in the production of food, robotics. In Latin America and the Caribbean, are we ready for this? Do we have the national systems we need to use these innovations? Information technologies, communication technologies, do we have the networks we need? I would say something you already know very well. We've had many gaps in technology, even before the pandemic, before COVID-19. Insufficient investment in innovation and development so that we may continue improving our processes in food production. A low level of funding when small producers, as you said, Patricia, who are so important for the whole chain, if they don't have the resources, it's hard for them to find a way out of any problems or diseases, for example, affecting their crops. They may not be able to pay for the pesticides they need. Rural connectivity as well. The ICT infrastructure is very sporadic in rural areas. This means producers don't have the possibility of communicating and seeing, for example, changes in temperature, even changes in prices that might affect them and might help them plan their production. And we know as well that investment in research and development in Latin America and the Caribbean has not been very large. There may be five countries, Brazil, Chile, Uruguay, Argentina, and Mexico. They're the ones that invest most in research and development. Most countries do not invest at all. So the result is low productivity, low added agricultural value per worker, if we want to measure it this way, in Latin America and the Caribbean is about $7,000 compared to $80,000 in the United States, value added per worker. And this low productivity affects everyone when we have a crisis like this. And it also impacts the way we can exit the crisis quickly. Thus, we have waste and loss of food because we just don't have the technology to process the foods in such a way to make them last longer through transport as well, how to take the products to market as quickly as possible. So these performance gaps have led to several problems. If we go to specific countries, we know that tropical countries have less progress if we compare them to temperate climate countries in terms of efficiency and sustainability of their agri-food chains. Smaller countries, again, have worse productivity gaps. So, we should think about the technologies that we can use and the systems we need to have in place so that we may use them, use the technologies. Because the technology is there, so how can we best take advantage of it? First of all, we need to have a program where R&D in technologies for the agri-food sector continues growing. Countries in Latin America and the Caribbean have to participate in that sense. Policies, standards, and frameworks need to be designed in a way that uses those technologies and to facilitate the inclusion of these technologies. ICT infrastructure, of course, very necessary, as I've already said. If a country has that goal, it is certainly achievable, of course, at a cost. And if we're talking about costs, financial services. We need to offer financial services to these small and medium producers so they have the ability of changing production if they find specific obstacles, so that they can continue producing, not just saying, well, that's it, I can't do it anymore, I'm migrating to another country, or I just don't produce anymore. And again, outreach and services. Here in the United States, we have a service that has existed for many years now, focused in universities like Texas A&M, my university. It's a very useful service because it helps small producers. It helps disseminate technologies and new knowledge so that they can also benefit from that. We do this along with the government. Ideally, it works that way, an outreach service where government and experts in universities and other areas come together to provide services that help small producers. And, of course, promoting markets. Once you have the technologies and you apply them, how you can let other countries know, countries you export to, that you already have that, that you're mobilizing in that sense, that you're ready and you have the ability of producing food that is in high demand. I think I can stop there. I don't want to take up too much time. Thank you very much, Elsa. That's very interesting. You've given us a good overview of what we're going through and what is coming. Now, I invite Juan Lucas. You have the floor, and then we will talk. Yes, thank you, Patricia, and warm greetings to Elsa. I'd like to congratulate Manuel Otero and his whole team at AICA for these very important fora, so important in the times of COVID-19. We definitely need to rethink what we're doing, what things, how things were going before, and this big shock makes us think and try to find an optimistic view to change our ways and see how our food systems can work in the region. So I think it's quite fortunate and it's great that Elsa is working with the Mutlu Institute, and we're talking about Norman Burdock, the father of the Green Revolution. And right now, I am in charge of two centers that are also from that Green Revolution, helping implement something that has been very successful for decades in closing the gaps of hunger in the world. Before this whole COVID problem, hunger remaining in the world was closely linked to political problems, problems in institutional quality. So it was not so much a matter of technologies, but more specific. And now this has changed. However, the model was very successful, or has been successful in that race to close the gaps of a caloric diet, a race to produce calories at the lowest unit cost possible to feed the poor in the world, whether living in cities or rural areas, at the best price possible. And that, of course, was fed by public systems, policies of different states and governments, and it led to the fact that today, just three crops, corn, rice, and wheat, make up more than 50% of the calories consumed by humans worldwide. And that, of course, was leveraged by a model of open commercial trade. Countries in Latin America, some have turned out as winners in this dynamics, such as Brazil. But the balance overall, if we compare our countries 20 years ago and today, the dependence on imported foods, especially of these main crops, grew importantly as well. So that's the first thing of the successful model to date, with a very specific goal that will probably be different, and we have to rethink from now onwards. Today, the theme and the big topic in challenge is that we need to find balance in our food system so that the agricultural side plus the environmental side are taken into consideration along with nutrition. All of them joined so that we can find the intersection that helps us find the new balance towards development of agriculture into the future. So our mandate, and from other institutions that have been changing their strategies as well, is much more focused on transforming food systems, not so much increasing competitiveness or productivity, or just thinking about efficiency measured in the lowest possible production costs per unit. So that has to be changed and rethought. To think differently, this crisis is like a big wake-up call, an opportunity, if you will, because we see consumers and human beings afraid. They are afraid and they have difficulties. It could be a small producer or an urban consumer, and people are starting to ask themselves, why the things that I did so easily before, like buying fruits or going to the cafe down the street, why are they not working? So things start changing, and consumers right now are very much aware. And the first recommendation for these types of discussions is that we have to use that opportunity and ask member countries to have food policies focus very strongly on consumers. The best way to work for producers is focusing on consumers. We need to understand their diet as a central matter, their intake, the nutritional quality of what reaches their plate. Thinking about diversity, also the planetary limits, the effort and the natural resources that are needed to bring that to the plate. And the plate itself, how respectful is it? How much in harmony is it with other goals, such as the protection of biodiversity against climate change? So there is definitely an important focus on consumers. If we look at the value chains specifically, there is a very critical topic. If we want to find a more diverse model, and of course I'm one of the people for free markets and competition, but still we need to promote models that are more diverse in our production landscapes in countries. So we may see more legumes, more nuts, more fruits and vegetables, a variety of foods that are so critical for our plates and that will diversify agricultural landscapes as well, thus bringing benefits to producers and working in a better equilibrium for the environment. Here, seeds are absolutely essential. And for that, we need to look at the regulatory side. The Green Revolution also helped stakeholders where the large plant enhancers or producers are large international companies linked to these crops. But to facilitate their development, we went against giving the openness for the registration of smaller crops or smaller seeds or crops that are from more endemic natures. If you look at it and analyze it from the scientific point of view, you find great diversity, looking at the adaptability and others, but also great potential in terms of providing better nutrition than the improved varieties we have today. Even the screening of germplasm banks of these international institutions has found great values of iron, vitamins, and others of crops that, through improvement of crops, have led to fortified crops. So there's an important matter of seeds, of regulation, so that we can help producers legally access and easily access a greater diversity of seeds. And this can also be taken to a large new discussion on bio-inputs. And it's important to protect these. I also agree fully in the fact that this is an important time. We're all working to understanding how to work from home, changing our schedules and all the different pressures we may have in this adaptation to new technologies. But many people are being very productive using these tools and knowing that we will come back to a different normality. What does this mean for farmers? How can we take the digital revolution to them? Elsa talked about outreach. Digital outreach will be fundamental. How can we ensure that a professional working in the agricultural side can connect to farmers, helping them with knowledge through technology? There are so many tools available. The only thing we have to be careful about is to ensuring that we're looking after specific interests, so that these are really extension tools and not, or outreach tools and not used to favor the interests of one over the other. We also need to find ways to cheapen the costs of research so that we can work with citizen science, for example, not with the very expensive tests, but finding a way where producers can give us their input working in real time, thousands of them, instead of a very costly laboratory experiment. There's so many other topics we can mention, depending on the time we have, but shorter chains, the big topic of agroecology, bioecology. For me, it's not really a dilemma. I'm very happy to be here in this conversation. This is just a first approach to communicate some ideas and have some fun together with our ideas. Thank you, Patricia. Thank you both. So we can begin the conversation to see if we can go deeper into some of the matters you've mentioned. It's clear then that we do have the technologies, as we heard from Elsa. The issue is how to bring them to our countries and to the first step, to the first part of the chain, thinking that the higher sectors have access, but the lower you go, they may not necessarily have that ease. So how can we bring innovation to impact throughout the chain, looking especially at the smaller ones? Well, that is the $10 million question. $10 million. One of the main points there is that many other countries, as you said, cannot participate still because they don't have the resources. One way is by helping them to participate in international fora where the regulatory frameworks are established for markets. That way they can have a voice and understand what is happening. So it's not the train running away from them and them being left behind. It's a good way for them to realize what markets exist, countries that may not necessarily have resources for research and development or for technology. They have products, as Juan Lucas mentioned, that are unique and are very sought after by consumers. So we have to find a way to help them participate in international dialogues. And countries that are having the resources that are buying these, coming to international agreements so that they can also bring the technologies to the smaller countries in collaboration. The CGIAR system, and CIET is part of this, is, for example, an appropriate place to start connecting technologies and countries that may need it. These types of centers precisely work on that type of research, always thinking about how to help the small producers that may not have the resources. So the first step is linking them, connecting ideas, and bringing these countries to participate, so that the markets that want to buy their products show their interest. And of course, it's in their interest to have the technology in the smaller country as well. And the country can have the advantage of bringing these products more efficiently to them and at a lower cost. Efficiency generally lowers production costs. So cooperation is definitely number one. Thank you, Elsa. Juan Lucas, would you like to add something? And also, with that same viewpoint, you mentioned it's important to start working with endemic species or local species that have great potential and that is not necessarily well known. How can we bring these two together? We need research. There's a lot of innovation to be made yet. Yes, I think that's actually part of the dilemma we find. I have been relatively critical of public policies in our region and even elsewhere in the world overall, where the different associations and guilds related to the large products, large commodities, are the biggest influencers in public policy. So I understand perfectly that to produce these commodities, you have efficiency, a scale, international markets that are reference points. And I don't think, at least not in Latin America, it may be different in other countries, for example, in Africa. But I don't think that these large crops are the solution for small producers in our region and to solve our rural poverty. But public policy we have in place today is perfectly adjusted precisely to support, subsidize, and maintain these large crops. We need to find new agreements to provide funding, science, technology, development of small and medium enterprises, on all focusing on opening spaces for other crops, so many others, that don't necessarily have to be endemic or unique to that place, but that still have the quality and the properties to better serve the purpose of our systems, to bring more diversity, to empower our producers within value chains. And therefore, it will also be important to take care of not being overly ambitious, saying we'll have this big agri-export program for the future. No, but let's just reduce the scale and look, for example, at school nutrition, school cafeterias, or food used to support heads of household and women in the region. These types of smaller programs, how can we link them to the products that may be more valuable nutritionally and where they do not have to travel around the world to find consumers? So to understand what it means to bring them together, we need a dual model, the coexistence of support to these large crops and commodities that, of course, will continue with its important development. But we need another portfolio of crops that is clearer and more geared at the preferences of consumers, that is even friendlier and careful with our planetary limits. That's the big dilemma. And this is global. Cooperation agencies are very stuck, if you will, on the main crops. So there is great space that is not funded, but there's wonderful opportunities there. Yes, if I may, Patricia, I'd like to say that I fully agree with Juan Lucas. And I'm thinking, for example, certain products that grow very well in Latin America. We have chocolate chocolate, coffee, high-value products. They've had their issues, coffee with certain diseases, and we found varieties that are resistant, and that's through technology. And here at the Imordec Institute, we've used that type of technology to improve varieties and have them be resistant to drought or disease. So that, in a way, gives an advantage to countries in Latin America. They may compete very well with others. If we look at coffee as an example, it's been found that you can now use different parts to produce tea, fermented products, and some products that have high demand by consumers today. So there's great opportunity. We just need to analyze them and plan to ensure they come real. Because if you continue doing the same thing over and over, you will not improve. And from what you are both saying, then, I think we would need a change of vision from government to see how we invest and what we invest in. And having food and agriculture at the first level, how can you achieve this? Of course, this is part of the objective with these seminars. Finding a way to contribute to make that change. Do you think that governments and public sectors should begin already now, or are they aware now that agriculture is as important as health? I would say so, yes. We will hear from Juan Lucas soon, but yes, of course. For a very basic reason, governments know that for them to survive and to have the resources, taxes, anything to be able to trade, they must support the agricultural sector, undoubtedly. For many years now, we know that no country can be self-sustainable, feeding themselves only. These countries will never achieve the goals they may have. Some countries have depended too much on oil, and when prices crash, they realize that they should have invested more in agriculture. And these types of lessons that many countries are learning now are the types of lessons we should also analyze so that we can have a plan and understand what products make sense for certain countries. Patricia, I think that, unfortunately, in this crisis, although it's a health crisis, it's also becoming a food crisis. Very different for now. Hopefully, we will not have it be the crisis of 2008-2009 that came through large restrictions in international exchange of food, and so very high prices. Here, the effect of global market exchange or commercial exchange is at least for now 15% of what we had in 2008. So we don't have a big problem yet. But there is a gigantic crisis in producers that don't find buyers, consumers that don't find who to buy from, producers that decide, why would I continue working with this crop if I don't know my market? And that profound damage to our food systems will lead to governments being very much aware in the coming years, not just about agriculture overall, but their whole food system and how that has to be changed, and having them also decide to shift from their current political model, because it will not be solved with the four or five large crops. And as for what Elsa said, tropical crops are fascinating to me. I think they are wonderful promoters of development. But who can move governments if they do not move? Well, the private sector. And the private sector worldwide is also now being very aware of how we will feed people in the future. I would like to invite you to visit the page of Unilever, one of the large producers of raw materials for food ingredients. They have done great work on the 50 foods of the future. And I assure you, these 50 foods are practically non-existent in the plates of any Latin American. They are comprised of grains, certain cereals different from what we consume, algae, fungi, especially the plant kingdom. Really interesting study, and they've identified these foods, given their nutritional potential, the possibility of creating specific value chains. And not just that, but they're also creating supply chains today for a global company based on these new ingredients for consumers' plates. So even large companies also are working on this. There's a consortium that's that has Danone and Nestle and all these big food producers in the World Business Council for Sustainable Development. And their discussion covers many domains, but they're also thinking about the future of food, the planetary limits, and how our plates have to have a different combination compared to our typical food, such as the bandeja paisa in Colombia or anywhere else, our common plate. So there's a big discussion for governments and consumers through the private sector to, again, rethink of their whole food system. We're talking about innovation. New seeds, incorporating what we already have or the seeds that we know, and bringing new products. Also new technologies, digitalizing. And with the big problem we have in our countries, if we think about Chile, for example, it's such a long country. If you go to the cities, you have great connection to internet. But if you go 50 kilometers away, there's no connection. How can we innovate or bring that innovation if we do not have connectivity? Well, yes, that's the problem, actually. And something else we haven't mentioned a lot, another technology, is food processing technology. So that we can refrain from using so many chemical preservatives. Many markets are trying to change this and looking to use more natural ingredients. That technology also is hard to find. It is costly, so you would need much capital investment to develop the formulas and to know how to process foods. And that is the problem as well. There's not enough capital. It's one of the things we've seen, for example, in Africa. Countries in the continent are coordinating better. They are unifying many things to be able to trade amongst themselves, but also joining forces so that together they can have these plans making sense for each country, depending on what each country can produce. But still together, finding a plan to export to Europe, to the Americas, Australia, etc. In finding a more organized way of trade. So they join resources as well. They do not have many resources, but bringing them together, they can achieve more. What you were mentioning of digitalization, Patricia, and how small producers, the poor, and those that are far from urban infrastructure for communication do not have access to large communication channels. I think that's not the right way of focusing on the problem. What we have to look at is, with the small access they may have, how can we adapt our systems and models for information collection and delivery so that they can do it, for example, through voice, mail, text messages, more simplified ways. And with just good artificial intelligence or good design, it can be just as efficient as a screen that is in full color and with all types of data. Sometimes we become very specific and we want to bring to producers what we can have in the 4G or 5G world. But what we have to do is actually adapt to the communications they have that may be falling behind if you look at the technology itself, but we can do many things in terms of outreach and governments quickly understanding and diagnosing interruptions in a value chain, etc. So I'm not a pessimist at all. I just think we have to look at the problem from that viewpoint. And in terms of transforming food, it's exactly the same. We always imagine this large food processing industry, but we actually have to descale technology to bring it to minimal systems, minimum sizes of efficiency, so that they are truly functional in small industries and in these small production places. Through AgroSavia, we had a very interesting project with a French organization where through microfiltration, there was fruit production and different safe products that could be easily preserved without refrigeration for several months with high organoleptic quality at a very small scale. So we can find these types of models, and this means breaking the normal commercial circuits. So again, transformation has to be thought at a local scale, a small scale. Hopefully a lesson we can learn from this discussion is let's understand the food systems first from the local so that we can design and focus research innovatively, working to solve the value chains we have already at the small scale with value added and everything else you may need to improve consumption. That's quite a challenge, yes. But it can be done. It can certainly be done. This is not rocket science. It's easier. Well, in the end, it's communication and collaboration, is it? I've heard this word quite a lot from both of you. Collaboration. Whether it's public-private, intra-regional, inter-regional, different sectors. That is what will allow innovation to expand and reach them. For example, with seeds, having seeds that, of course, need to meet certain parameters. They have to be productive, not contaminated with diseases, etc. But we need everyone to have access to that. So is collaboration one of the keys? Yes, of course. And also access to seeds, that's essential. If we don't have that, you cannot even start. There's also worldwide organizations and foundations, such as the Bill Gates Foundation and others, here in the US, the International Development Agency, And in Europe, they have theirs as well. They're all quite interested in supporting this type of effort. So it's a matter of... Well, what happens a lot in this area, I don't know what you think, Juan Lucas, but I think we might have a project here, another one over there, another project here, but they're not connected. So we're repeating the same things in isolation. But the lessons we learn are not connected, are not brought together so that we can finally learn and decide. Based on what we've seen here, we can do it differently over there. Not repeating the same things over and over again in different places. If we don't have better coordination, it will continue so. Yes, there's of course great problems in terms of coordination. Collaboration might be easy to say that we need it, but it's difficult to execute because we find that the interests of different agents are hard to align. But there's also very good practices, success cases. And the first thing countries should do in this type of pandemic is, if you have a menu of options before you and you have all types of sellers and salespeople, you need to have the capacity and the support with robust platforms that can be honest agents to help you find the models for economic reactivation and transformation of the agri-food system. So that we truly have a possibility of having some arbitrators, if you will, to help them decide what are the most efficient collaboration models. But here again, changing standards and regulations is fundamental. These regulations today are hostile to the small-scale production, to whatever is new, to helping a new enterprise working with endemic products. Because these regulations are hostile towards these types of new developments. In the FAO, we do not see a recognition of what the FAO has recognized in Latin America, at least not in the registration of products in Latin America. So we need very specific products for these materials, guaranteeing safety, health, but not requiring the same things they require from a hybrid or a variety of these large global companies. That will not help us find a more diverse landscape with more opportunities for producers. And that would probably help the chain work and continue bringing products to the world, having diversity and quality. That's a combination. Right. Would you like to add anything else? Any other comments? From what I see, some keywords towards the future are new regulations, considering changes coming, internal and external collaboration, incorporating new technologies, new seeds and new ways of trade, even transport and processing of foods. So I think those are the big points we see in terms of innovation and transferring knowledge. Any other comments? Any insights to share? Yes, thank you very much for the opportunity. I know Juan Lucas and his center, they work a lot on research in that sense. Anyone interested in hearing us, I invite you to explore through the internet all the activities that AICA is following and organizing, coordinating efforts, and also the different research centers. You can find them whether through the CGIAR system or in different universities all over the world, just as we have it here at Texas. Thank you. Thank you, Elsa. Yes, thank you. I also want to bring something else up, and that might be for another conversation later, but it's related to these models, the R&D models in the agricultural sector. There have been different streams. Some have been considered social, where agroecology, regenerative agriculture have been attacked because they have been said to lack enough scientific knowledge. I think that science has advanced so much in the last 10 to 15 years in closing knowledge gaps to show that these complex models also have great value and that it can be approached from science as well. So I think it's the time now to find that midpoint where biotechnology and all these new tools that we have that are so powerful and important, because of course, again, we need to continue using and taking advantage of them, that we can bring a way to use them in harmony with models that are more regenerative of circular economy, etc., so that we can close that gap. If we do not start these conversations thinking about the planetary limits, if we continue fighting and discussing from extremes, we will not get anywhere. And as Elsa said, our alliance is also part of that consortium, the CGIAR. We are working on a response for the whole consortium to COVID-19, not only for this time now, but for recovery. And the CIAT and our web pages, I invite you to find information on the Alliance of Biodiversity International, more on what we've commented today. Thank you very much. Quite interesting. And yes, there's many more topics open to have further conversations. Let's tell Manuel to have a new forum later on. Sure. I think this is definitely a great contribution to agriculture worldwide. Thank you very much. Thank you. And thank you, Patricia, for moderating this great talk. It's wonderful to have seen you, Elsa, even if only virtually. A warm embrace to you. Thank you. Same. Greetings to all. Thank you.